people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
I'm your host, Uzma Jafri, with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. The Pentagon is not taking any action against the drone strike that killed 10 civilians, including 7 children, in August. US, which had earlier referred to the incident as tragic mistake, has now called it a result of execution errors. Meanwhile, the UN has expressed deep concerns over the rapidly deteriorating human rights situation in the country, where it said reprisal attacks, attack on freedom of speech and activism was becoming increasingly pervasive.
The Pentagon this week said that no US military personnel would be held accountable for the August drone strike in Kabul that killed 10 civilians, including 7 children. An investigation by the Air Force Inspector General said the August 29 strike was caused by execution errors, interpreting information that supported certain viewpoints and communication breakdowns. The military had previously called the strike a tragic mistake. Pentagon spokesman John Kirby told reporters that senior commanders had made a number of recommendations to Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin about the incident, none of which included any accountability measures for specific personnel.
If the secretary believed that in the case of the 29 August airstrike that accountability was warranted and needed, he would certainly support those kinds of efforts. As General Saeed briefed to you, and as we discovered when again the two combatant commanders took a look at General Saeed's report, what we saw here was a breakdown in process, and execution in procedural events, not the result of negligence, not the result of misconduct, not the result of poor leadership.
Meanwhile, the United Nations has expressed deep concern over what is unfolding in Afghanistan with every rising sun. UN said more than 100 former Afghan National Security Forces and others have been killed since the Taliban takeover in August, most at the hands of the hardline Islamist group, which is recruiting boy soldiers and quashing women's rights. Nada Al-Nashif, UN Deputy High Commissioner for Human Rights, said that in addition, at least 50 suspected members of a local affiliate of Islamic State known as ISIS Khorasan, an ideological foe of the Taliban, died by hanging and beheading. In a speech to the Human Rights Council, she described Taliban rule as being marked by extrajudicial killings across the country and restrictions on women's and girls' basic rights.
We are also alarmed by continuing reports of extrajudicial killings across the country, despite the general amnesty announced by the Taliban after 15 August. Between August and November, we received credible allegations of more than 100 killings of former Afghan National Security Forces and others associated with the former government, with at least 72 of these killings attributed to the Taliban. In several cases, the bodies were publicly displayed. This has, of course, exacerbated fear among this sizable category of the population.
The UN said that families are facing severe poverty and hunger this winter amid reports of child labor, early marriages and even the sale of children. The Taliban has not just been killing people, but it has also been displaying the bodies publicly, which has exacerbated the fear among the sizable category of the population. The statements also underlined that the Taliban decree earlier this month that failed to refer to women's and girls' rights to education, work, and their freedom of movement and to participate in public life.
The Indo-Nepal friendship is an ever-building legacy, and it keeps getting its share of virtues added with time. Whether it is trade, politics, or people-to-people connect, the ties have been witnessing a consistent uptick for decades. And now, when the two countries are recording a significant decline in infections, the authorities have decided to resume the bus service between the two sides that has been lying suspended for past 1.5 years.
Passengers travelling from New Delhi to Nepal's capital Kathmandu were elated as the bus service between two capitals resumed after being suspended for over 1.5 years due to the COVID-19 pandemic. The Delhi bus service between the two countries, which was launched in 2014, has provided a boost to the trade, tourism and people-to-people connect between the two sides. The regular passengers said they were delighted after the resumption of the services, as they would again be able to continue their intra-country affairs seamlessly.
यहाँ पे लगभग daily routine पे लोग आते जाते रहते हैं, तो इसके लिए आपको कुछ private जो बसें थी उसमें proper तरीके से चालू नहीं हो रही थी, plus काफी ज़्यादा security reasons थे, तो इसी बीच में जैसे चालू हुआ तो शुरुआत में काफी अच्छा है क्योंकि इससे security का भी काफी ध्यान रखा जाता है, plus direct bus होता है, बीच में कुछ दिक्कत की बातें नहीं आती है.
In order to travel by the bus, the passengers will be required to produce a COVID-19 vaccine certificate and a RT-PCR test conducted within 72 hours before boarding. The decision was taken despite India imposing ban on several international flights and a mandatory protocol for people coming from countries where Omicron variant of COVID-19 is prevalent. The two countries already share an open border and unhindered movement of people. They have close people-to-people bonds through marriages and family ties. Culturally, India and Nepal are considered one entity. At least 8 million Nepalese live in India and they don't need a visa. They are given facilities and opportunities at par with Indian citizens. As close neighbors, India and Nepal share a unique relationship of friendship. Nepal shares 1,850-kilometer long open border with India. It stretches along 5 Indian states of Uttarakhand, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, West Bengal and Sikkim. Citizens travelling on either side have lauded the inter-government efforts and say the rule-based move will protect their lives and businesses.
They mentioned that we need to give vaccine certificate and identity card, so we don't have any trouble in the border. So it is very good for us, so we can save the people's life.
Trade along India and Nepal border is unmatched. India is Nepal's largest trading partner and the bilateral trade between the two sides reached $8.27 billion in 2018-19. India's export to Nepal is of $7.76 billion. Common citizens of Nepal feel India is like home to them and it does not feel like any other country.
Moving on, India and Bangladesh share a bond of liberation and victory, which is 16th December. 50 years ago, in 1971, erstwhile East Pakistan gained independence with Indian assistance after a 24-year rule by immoral Pakistani politicians. Millions of poor Bangladeshis perished at the hands of brute Pakistani forces. However, a 13-day full-fledged two-front war culminated with Bangladesh's independence on 16th December 1971. Both countries recently paid homage to the martyrs and observed the Liberation Day. Have a look.
This iconic picture of Pakistani General AAK Niazi surrendering unconditionally to the Indian Army not just marked the breakup of Pakistan, but also an end of Pakistan's tyranny on Bangladeshis, which is celebrated by all Indians and Bangladeshis to date. Bangladesh held Victory Day celebrations in Dhaka to mark the victory of Bangladesh over Pakistan in the 1971 war. Indian President Ramnath Kovind was the chief guest. Bangladesh is celebrating the Golden Jubilee of its independence from Pakistan this year. Bangladesh, or East Pakistan, as it was known after independence from the British, and its guerrilla resistance movement, Mukti Bahini, won the 1971 war with the help of Indian military forces and separated itself from West Pakistan on December 16. Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi paid tribute to the soldiers who laid down their lives in the war at a war memorial in the capital, New Delhi. Modi, who was accompanied by Indian Defence Minister Rajnath Singh, laid a wreath at National War Memorial and paid tribute to commemorate the occasion. India's Border Security Force and Border Guards Bangladesh organized a joint beating retreat program to celebrate the 50th anniversary of their joint victory over Pakistan in the 1971 war. India and Bangladesh have maintained close ties since then. The troops also exchanged sweets on the occasion.
बांग्लादेश जो विक्ट्री डे आप देख रहे हैं तो हम भी उसी उत्साह के साथ आज इस दिवस को मना रहे हैं बीजेपी के साथ और भी जो लोकल जितने यहाँ के हैं तो वो सब इसको विटनेस करने आए थे और आपने भी विटनेस किया होगा तो ये हमारे दोस्ती का प्रतीक है आज का दिन विशेष है
About 3 million people were killed in the war. Bangladesh won independence with India's help in December 1971 following a 9-month war against West Pakistan. India's decisive military victory over Pakistan in the third war between the neighbors, which led to the creation of Bangladesh as a separate nation, is considered one of the country's greatest military victories.
Moving on, massive protests have erupted in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir following a brutal murder and rape of a teen in Dadyal district. Although the accused, a Pakistani national, has been apprehended following unprecedented public outrage, the system has apparently been dragging its feet in bringing the culprit to justice. Kashmiris, however, are demanding his public execution and say will not call off their agitation till the perpetrator is hanged.
Thousands of Kashmiris have taken to the streets of Dadyal in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir against one of the most heinous crimes the region has witnessed in its history, a brutal, traumatizing rape and murder of a juvenile by a Pakistani citizen. The incident, in which a 13-year-old Kamal Matloob was defiled and beheaded by a Pakistani national, has drawn unparalleled condemnation and anger. Carrying pictures of Kamal while some are demanding an expeditious trial into the case, others are unwilling to settle for anything lesser than public execution. From children to the elderly, all have launched a movement for justice, and they say they will not return home or forget the crime until the accused is hanged.
Let's go!
Human rights violations are not a new thing to Kashmiris living under Pakistani occupation for over 7 decades. But a crime of such nature has shaken the conscience of one and all. Locals say it has added an unimaginable component to the barbarities people of the region have been enduring.
जिस वाकया को बयान करते हुए भी दिल खून के आंसू रो रहा हो, उस दरिंदा सिफ्त इंसान ने उसको कत्ल किया, उसका सर तन से जुदा किया, फिर वापस वो पंजाब चला गया, वो रियासत का
कासिम।
यहाँ पे जो है हर बंदा आके जुल्म सितम करता है, हर बंदा आके अपनी इजारादारी कर रहा है, और हम कब तक खामोश रहेंगे? हम सबको बाहर निकला होगा,
People have urged the government to take swift action before they turn to a violent alternative. They said they will not tolerate any delay in the execution of the accused.
हर तबके को हम ये मैसेज देना चाहते हैं कि कमल मजलूम कोई नावारिस हकी नहीं है, और शहर का बच्चा बुढ़ा और जवान उसके पुश के पीछे खड़े। तुमने जुर्म किया और तुम्हें इस जालिम को फांसी देनी पड़ेगी। इस जालिम की फांसी में अब अहले-ए-दीन दुनिया किसी ताखीर को भी बर्दाश्त नहीं करेंगे।
Crime against women in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir is growing by the day. While locals want their daughters to educate and progress in life, there is an inherent bias against them, both at societal and governmental level in Pakistan, that wants to keep them subjugated and backward. And this is one of the reasons the authorities have never cared for the security and protection of girls in the region. People, however, are determined this time and say they will not let their child perish without the criminal being brought to justice.
And now in our section of Asia this week, the stories from across the continent that hit the headlines this week.
Japanese company NEC has developed Face Express, a face recognition system at Narita Airport. After registration of the passenger's face, one can move forward and pass the boarding procedure, leaving baggage, security check, boarding gate, and other steps without showing the boarding pass or the passport at every checkpoint. For privacy reasons, face recognition data will be deleted within 24 hours of registration. Equipped with latest technology, Face Express NEC has come up with a new and a more convenient system. It has the most accurate image recognition in the world and guarantees security under all adverse circumstances. Global transportation business company NYK Group has come up with Sail Green project. It is defined by the midterm management plan of the company and is declared ESG, or Environmental, Social and Governance Model project. Car carrying business aims to operate transportation which is least damaging to environment. Under it, shipbuilding work is carried out to reduce CO2 of LNG gas fuel material carriers. In dynamic changing era of energy resource, NYK Group is concentrating on contributing to social change. More than 10 months since Myanmar's military seized power, the country's human rights situation is deepening on an unprecedented scale. In recent weeks, the UN Human Rights Office has received multiple reports of villages being burned, including protected structures such as places of religious worship and residential buildings. The United Nations Human Rights Office said they are appalled by the alarming escalation of grave human rights abuses in Myanmar. Spokesman for UN High Commissioner for Human Rights, Rupert Colville, also said that since the coup, General Ming Ong Leng's forces have repeatedly failed to respect their obligations under international law to protect the country's people. As a result, more than 1,300 individuals have lost their lives and another 10,600 have been detained. Gulf Arab leaders recently met in Riyadh for an annual summit expected to stress cohesion after a deep rift at a time of regional concern over Iran and rising economic rivalry within the oil-producing bloc. The Saudi Crown Prince toured Gulf states ahead of the summit, which comes nearly a year after Riyadh put an end to 3.5-year Arab boycott of Qatar that had shattered the US-allied Gulf Cooperation Council. Saudi Arabia and non-Gulf Egypt have restored diplomatic ties with Doha, but United Arab Emirates and Bahrain have yet to do so, though Abu Dhabi has moved to mend fences. Sunni Muslim Saudi Arabia and Shiite Iran are vying for influence in a rivalry that has played out across the region in events such as Yemen's war and in Lebanon, where Iran-backed Hezbollah's rising power has frayed Beirut's Gulf ties. Riyadh and Abu Dhabi, concerned about Iran's nuclear ambitions, missile program and regional proxies, are engaging with Tehran to contain tension. Abu Dhabi has moved faster to improve ties with Iran and Turkey, while also re-engaging with Syria after forging relations with Israel last year.
Moving on. Being an agrarian society, India celebrates a number of festivals that are directly or indirectly linked to the farming community. One among them is Kambala, which is an annual buffalo race held in the southwestern state of Karnataka and is observed with much enthusiasm and fervor. Take a look.
A spectacular sport and an entertaining event, Kambala is one of the grand festivals observed mostly in Dakshina Kannada district of Karnataka. It is a popular and a unique sport among the farming community of the state, in which buffaloes race on a muddy track that are held parallel to each other. Each team comprises of two buffaloes and a farmer who controls them. Two teams are made to race down two slushy tracks plogged in the muddy field to determine the fastest team. This year, more than 200 pairs of buffaloes participated in the race that was held at Muda Bidri in Dakshina Kannada district of the state.
ವೀರರಾಣಿ ಹಬ್ಬಕ್ಕ ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತಿ ಗ್ರಾಮದಲ್ಲಿ ಹತ್ತೊಂಬತ್ತನೇ ವರ್ಷದ ಕೋಟಿ ಜನ ಜೋಡುಕರೆ ಕಂಬಳ.
ಫಾರ್ ದ ರೇಸ್ ದ ಚೂಸನ್ ಬಫೆಲೋಸ್ ಅಂಡರ್ಗೋ ರಿಗರಸ್ ಟ್ರೈನಿಂಗ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಆರ್ ಫೆಡ್ ಆನ್ ಅ ಸ್ಪೆಷಲ್ ಡೈಟ್. ಆನ್ ದ ಡೇ ಆಫ್ ದ ಫೆಸ್ಟಿವಲ್ ದ ಬಫೆಲೋಸ್ ಆರ್ ಮೇಡ್ ಟು ವೇರ್ ಡೆಕೋರೇಟಿವ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಕಲರ್ಫುಲ್ ಹೆಡ್ ಕೇರ್ಸ್ made of brass and silver, and ropes are tied as a bridle. The race continues till midnight and the winning pair is rewarded with a cash prize and coconuts, but traditionally it was not a competitive sport in which buffaloes run in the field one by one. It is witnessed by a huge crowd of enthusiastic onlookers and supporters for whom race become the show of strength and valor.
Are like a festival for us. Every year we come and watch here, we celebrate here. We love to watch the buffaloes running, and it's like a grand festival over here.
Over the centuries, the age-old festival of Kambala has managed to grow in popularity. At present, around 18 Kambalas are held in one season, which starts after the harvest in November and ends in April in different villages.
The word Kambala has been derived from Kampa Kala. While the word Kampa is related to slushy, Kala means field where it happens. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.
People have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.